Hello everyone, this is Srija. Let us start our second video on various institutions, terms, schemes, concepts that appeared in today's newspaper and that will help you to understand Rambabu sir's video on news analysis. And at the end of this video, today we are going to give you a task. Let us start with our first article, The Rocky Road to 2019. In this article, we need to see what is this Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act. This act was enacted in 1989 in order to protect the vulnerable sections of the society. Those are the Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes. And this act has got amended in 2015 to cover newer forms of discrimination and crimes against Dalits and tribals. This act is a comprehensive law which not only defines atrocities against scheduled castes and scheduled tribes but also makes several rules, regulations for proper protection of these vulnerable classes. Now let us see what are the various provisions that were provided by this act to protect these vulnerable classes. As per this act, there is a provision to establish exclusive special courts and exclusive special public prosecutors to enable speedy disposal of the cases. And the trial of the case has to be completed within 2 months from the date of filing the charge sheet. The law states that any public servant, if he is neglecting his duties, that is, if he is showing negligence to register a complaint that is related to SCs or STs, he'll be punished with an imprisonment for a term of 6 months to 1 year. Section 18 of this act, it will bar grant of anticipated bail to anyone accused of violating its provisions. If the accused was acquainted with the victim, that means if the person who was accused, if he knows the victim, the court will presume that the accused was aware of the caste or tribal identity of the victim unless it is proved. The nodal agency to enforce this act is Ministry of Social Justice. In this article, there is a mention of two terms, communal violence and regional subnationalism. We'll see what those mean in detail. In this article, there is another term called impeachment. Impeachment means removing a person from their office for something wrong done by them on various grounds. In India, this process of impeachment is limited to president and judges of High Court and Supreme Court. The president will be removed before the expiry of the term of his office through the process of impeachment for violating Constitution of India by the Parliament of India. The process can start in either of the two houses of the Parliament, but the moment the motion is passed by both houses, the president will cease to be the president. Whereas in case of judges, it has to be on the grounds of misbehavior or incapacity. Whereas in case of the motion for removal of judge, it is the president who has to consider issuing the necessary order after the motion was passed by both the houses. Till then, the judge cannot be removed. In order to know this communal violence, first we should know what is communalism. It denotes the differences between various religious groups and differences among the people of different community, which means people with common secular interests of one religion are dissimilar and divergent from the interests of the followers of another religion. These differences will lead to communal violence between these groups. So we can say that communal violence is mobilization of people belonging to two different religious communities against each other, carrying the feelings of hostility, exploitation, social discrimination, and social neglect. Now let us see what does this regional subnationalism means. It is the aspirations of a particular community within a nation to express their identity in different forms rather than only being an Indian. For example, the demand for a state flag is raised apart from having a national flag represents that the people as also identify themselves as people of that particular state too, rather than only being identified as Indians. It will allow them to represent the interests of their states or province as separate from the nation's collective interests. The next article is on DNA profiling bill in monsoon session, center informs the Supreme Court. In this article, there are various terms that we need to know. The first one is PIL, which means public interest litigation. What is public interest litigation? As we know that we are all provided with basic fundamental rights by the Constitution. If any of those rights get infringed, we can seek redress under Article 32. It is, in ordinary cases, it is only the aggrieved person or the party will have the right to seek redress under Article 32. Prior 1980s, only the aggrieved party could approach the courts for justice. But now, according to this public interest litigation, any member of the public can initiate legal proceedings on behalf of an aggrieved person, especially a person who is unable to move the court on his or her own. Which means that instead of insisting that only a person whose fundamental rights have been infringed can file a petition, it is permitted that a public-spirited citizen to move the court for the enforcement of the constitutional and legal rights of a person or groups because of their poverty or economically disadvantaged position were unable to approach the court for relief. Here, the person bringing the case to the court should not do it for personal gains or private profit or political motivation or any other reasons. The Supreme Court, by permitting public interest litigation, it has considerably widened the scope of Article 32 of the Constitution. In terms of the principles of public interest litigation, under Article 32, the Supreme Court can interfere whenever and wherever any injustice is caused or being caused by the state action to the poor and helpless person who cannot approach the court. Now, the next term is mandamus. Let us see what is this mandamus. Mandamus is a type of writ. First of all, let us know what is a writ. Anything that is issued under an authority is called as a writ. For example, the orders, warrants, directions, etc. Anything issued under authority are the examples of writs. So, mandamus is one of the writ. Mandamus here means we command. This writ is a command issued by a court to a public official, public body, corporation, inferior court, tribunal, or government, asking them to perform their duties which they have refused to perform. Due to this, mandamus is called a awakening call, and it awakes the sleeping authorities to perform their duty. A petition for writ of mandamus can be filed by any person who seeks a legal duty to be performed by a person or a body. Such a filing person must have real or special interest in the subject matter and must have legal right to do so. As I have said, mandamus can be issued against these people, but mandamus cannot be issued against certain people. We'll see who are they. Mandamus cannot be issued against these people, against the private individual or a private body, if the duty in question is discretionary and not mandatory, against president or governors of state. It cannot be issued against a working chief justice, and it cannot be issued to enforce some kind of private contract. Now let us see the main concept called DNA profiling. What is DNA profiling about? The DNA profiling, which is also called as DNA fingerprinting or DNA testing or DNA typing, is a forensic technique used to identify individuals by characteristics of their DNA. This DNA profile is a small set of DNA variations that is different for different individuals, in all the unrelated individuals. Now let us see where this DNA profiling is used. Where is it helpful? It is helpful to convict serious criminals, and possibly it helps to prevent crime. And it is helpful in the aftermath of a natural disaster to identify the disaster victims. It is even helpful in identifying missing persons and human remains. It is also helpful for medical research purposes and in establishing parentage or blood relations between individuals. It also helps to in the study of animal and floral populations. It will help to address the issue of thousands of unclaimed dead bodies that are reported annually. The next article is Iran deal built on lies, says Pompeo. In this article, we should know about what is this Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, which is commonly known as Iran deal or Iran nuclear deal. It is an international agreement on the nuclear program of Iran reached in Vienna on July 2015 between the countries of Iran, P5+1, and the European Union. The countries in P5+1 are the 5 permanent members of the United Nations Security Council, China, France, Russia, UK, US, and that is the plus one is Germany, plus Germany and European Union. Under this agreement, certain conditions were imposed on Iran, where Iran agreed to eliminate its stockpile of medium enriched uranium, cut its stockpile of low enriched uranium by 98%, and reduced by about 2/3 the number of its gas centrifuges for 13 years, and some other conditions it has agreed. In order to monitor and verify Iran's compliance with the agreement, the International Atomic Energy Agency will have regular access to all the Iranian nuclear facilities. International Atomic Energy Agency. We'll see about this in detail. The agreement provides that in return for verifiably abiding by its commitments, Iran will receive relief from US, European Union and the United Nations Security Council nuclear related economic sanctions. This is an international organization that seeks to promote the peaceful use of nuclear energy and to inhibit its use for military purpose, including nuclear weapons and materials. It was established as an autonomous organization, which is not under direct control of the United Nations, but reports to both United Nations General Assembly and the Security Council. It is widely known as the world's atoms for peace organization. It is headquartered at Vienna with 168 member nations. North Korea has withdrawn its candidature from International Atomic Energy Agency. This agency developed a program of action for cancer therapy. Program of action for cancer therapy that responds to the needs of developing countries to establish to improve or to expand radiotherapy treatment programs. The next article is Aadhaar biometric data is 100% secure. In this article, there is a mention about CERT, which is Computer Emergency Response Team. This is a nodal agency for information technology security. And this functions under the Department of Information Technology, Ministry of Electronics and IT. This agency was established to protect Indian cyberspace and software infrastructure against destructive and hacking activities. The objectives of this agency were to prevent cyber attacks against the country's cyberspace and respond to cyber attacks and minimize damage and recovery time, reducing national vulnerability to cyber attacks, and to enhance security awareness among common citizens. This will also respond to computer security incidents and reports on vulnerabilities and promote effective IT security practices throughout the country. The next article is Core sector growth slows to 4.1% in March. In this article, we should know what is this core sector. Core industry can be defined as the main industry of the economy. In most countries, there is a particular industry that seems to be the backbone of all other industries, and that industry will be qualified to be called as the core industry or a core sector. In India, there are 8 core sectors. They are coal, crude oil, natural gas, refinery products, fertilizers, steel, cement, and electricity. The index of these 8 core industries, that is, this core sector growth, will be released by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry in India. In this article, there is another term called Index of Industrial Production. We'll see what it is. This index captures the industrial activity in the economy. It will help us to understand the growth of various sectors in the Indian economy, such as mining, electricity, and manufacturing. This index of industrial production is a composite indicator used to measure short-term changes in the volume of production of the basket of industrial products, that is, these 3 sectors, during a given period with respect to a chosen base period. The present base year is 2011-12. We'll see if the base year of the index is given a value of 100. As we know, the current base year for this index of industrial production in India is 2011-12. So, if the current index reads 120, it means there has been a 20% industrial growth compared to the base year of 2011-12. And this index is compiled and published monthly by Central Statistics Organization under Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. The next article is Supreme Court admits petition to quash Section 377. What is this Section 377? This was introduced during British rule by Lord Macaulay in 1860 as a part of Indian Penal Code. This Section 377 of IPC defines unnatural offences. And this Section 377 criminalizes homosexuality. Homosexuality in the sense, it is a sexual attraction between members of same gender. Section 377 criminalizes homosexuality or acts against the order of nature. That is carnal intercourse against the order of nature, which means whoever voluntarily has carnal intercourse against the order of nature with any man, woman or animal with or without consent will be punished. The maximum punishment is imprisonment for life under the Section 377 of IPC. And our next article is People are safer now than they were several hundred years ago. In this article, there is mention about artificial intelligence. What is artificial intelligence? It is the branch of computer science concerned with making computers behave like humans. That means the ability of a machine to perform cognitive functions we associate with human mind, such as perceiving, reasoning, learning, interacting with the environment, problem solving, and even exercising creativity. What are the applications of this artificial intelligence? Some of the major applications are seen in the creation of machines or robots that can perform human tasks without errors, like autonomous driverless cars that can prevent accidents due to human errors. As they don't require brakes like humans, they provide higher levels of productivity in lesser time than humans. Higher productivity, which is a benefit. Artificial intelligence also finds extensive and significant application in the medical sciences. Robots can perform complex surgeries with precision, that means with accuracy. They record huge amount of information that can be used for individualized treatments, avoid research works, etc. Developing countries like India can creatively use this technology to find unique solutions for problems related to sanitation, education, agriculture, etc. This can also be used for weather predictions and can efficiently help in disaster management. Other than the efficiency, machines have advantages over negative effects of human emotions as well. That can take more rational and logical decisions than those based on various human sentiments. The next article is sub-village units will be powered too. In this article, there is mention about a scheme called Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana. We'll see what it is. It is a flagship scheme launched with an aim to provide 24/7 uninterrupted electricity supply to each and every rural household. Let us see why this scheme was launched. The rural, agricultural and non-agricultural consumers are generally serviced through local distribution network. Most of the rural areas face insufficient electric supply. Consequently, the distribution utilities are forced to resort to load shedding, thus affecting the power supply to both agriculture and non-agricultural consumers. And the other one is due to increased demand for power in rural areas due to changing consumer base. And the investment in distribution network is low due to bad financial health of distribution companies. In order to address all these problems, the scheme was launched to provide 24/7 uninterrupted electricity supply to each and every rural household. The objectives of this scheme is to focus on feeder separation. The rural feeder separation or segregation means separating technical infrastructure of agricultural consumers from non-agricultural consumers and strengthening sub-transmission and distribution infrastructure at all levels in rural areas. This will help in providing round-the-clock power to rural households and adequate power to agricultural consumers. The benefits from this scheme are: all the villages and households will be electrified. It will increase agricultural yield. Business of small and household enterprises will grow, resulting into new avenues for employment. It improves health, education, banking services. It improves accessibility to radio, telephone, television, internet and mobile, etc. It will result in betterment of social security due to availability of electricity. This scheme results into the accessibility of electricity to schools, panchayats, hospitals and police stations. And the rural areas will get increased opportunities for comprehensive development. So, as I've said you in the starting that you're going to have a task at the end of this video. So, we have come up with this concept of giving you prelims questions every day based on our video. So, do comment your answers to these questions. So, we'll be discussing these questions in tomorrow's video. Thank you.